brother. Ahmed Osman, how are you? That's how this building here in the middle, 104. That's kind of gonna,
which one?
Over there, I'm gonna show you the picture of Malcolm talking in the street over there. It says Harlem Heritage. Yes. We own that property there.
My name is Ahmed Sadiq Osman, known by Ahmed Osman. I am originally from Sudan, from Nubia, from the village of Argin, which is about 20 kilometers south of Abu Simbel. In 1960, the headmaster of the school came and told us there is a competition, an essay competition. Whoever wins it will go to America. So I participated in that competition. I was selected to represent Sudan in the New York Herald Tribune World Youth Forum. After that, I went to Sudan, joined the University of Khartoum. Then in my second year, I applied for American colleges. Among them were Brandeis and Dartmouth College. Both of them gave me good scholarships, but I chose Dartmouth because the scholarship was given by the class of 1956. And the condition of the scholarship was that I spent all my vacations with the families of the class of 56. So that really gave me the opportunity to know America from inside. So that is how I came to the United States.
When did you arrive here?
I arrived in September or August 1962. One day I was visiting my friends at the Sudan Mission to the United Nations. So we went to Harlem, and we were walking around. So we came, I believe, around 125th and Lenox Avenue. And then I saw this sign, Muhammad's Temple Number 7. So I told my friend, this is where Malcolm X, gives his speeches. How about going in? He said, okay. So we went in, and it happened that Malcolm was speaking to the congregation. There were about 500 people. And he was really quite an impressive speaker. After the speech, he opened the floor for questions. So I raised my hand, and they gave me the opportunity. Then I told Malcolm, of course, from what I hear, you people, you have accepted Islam because there is no discrimination in Islam. But from what I hear, you come here and you condemn the white man as being the devil. And there is no place for any kind of discrimination in Islam.
The white man brings it in. The white man brings it to Harlem. The white man makes you a drug addict. The white man then puts you in jail when he catches you using drugs. Who is it that controls the prostitution in Harlem? It's the white man. Who controls the large sales of whiskey and wine? It's the white man.
Of course, the crowd was quite upset. And a stranger coming and challenging their leader. But Malcolm, he said, no, let him speak up his mind. He said, I was in Sudan, I visited Sudan, I went to Omdurman, I was very much impressed with the brothers and sisters I met in Omdurman, especially with Ahfad College, which was the fairest Sudanese women college. And he said, I was very impressed with my brothers and sisters in Omdurman. But when I went to Khartoum, I found a white devil there. So I told him, Brother Malcolm, I challenge you. There is no human being that you can call devil in Islam. So he opened the Quran, and he read for me the verse. And the verse in Arabic is said, وَيَوْمَ نَحْشُرُ الْمُجْرِمِينَ أَزْدُرُقَ, which he translated, on the day of judgment, we are going to put in hell the white devils. He translated the word Zuruqa, which in Arabic means blue. He translated, these are the blue-eyed devils. I told him, no, brother, this is a misinterpretation. It doesn't mean that. So we exchanged addresses, and we started communicating with each other from that time.
To America, we were living in the east. By the Nile River, we were living in luxury.
Sudan, عند مالكوم إكس. متى بدأ مالكوم إكس يعرف ما هو السودان وهو في تلك القارة البعيدة؟
طبعاً قرأ تاريخ أفريقيا.
أيوة.
وشاف إنه الحضارات أساساً بدأت في أفريقيا. وأقدم حضارة طبعاً في أفريقيا هي حضارة وادي النيل. اللي هي الحضارة النوبية أو حضارة كوش. وعشان كده هو بدأ من المرحلة دي إنه يبدأ يستكشف الحضارات. إنه أساس الحضارات العالمية كلها
كان
هي أساساً بدأت في السودان وبعدك انتشرت للعالم الآخر فده كان سبب مجيئه للسودان
البيض في أمريكا بيقولوا لنا نحن الزنوج ما عندكم كلتشر وما عندكم تاريخ فأنا جاي وجايب معايا السينما بتاعت السيني كاميرا علشان يصور ويوري الزنوج في أمريكا الأمريكان السود أنه أنتوا عندكم حضارة وعندكم كذا
Nobody wants us at their door So my friend it's easy to tell White man heaven is black man hell
This is a letter from Malcolm X that he sent me in return for a letter I sent him and some of the booklets about Islam that I sent him. So he is acknowledging in this letter that he received the book, thanking me for them and asking me to translate two verses of the Quran. So this really indicates that he started questioning some of his beliefs and some of the things that I argued with him when I visited him the first time in Harlem. So I used to live nearby here, and on Friday I would come and make my Jummah prayers in this Islamic center. At that time, the director of the center was Dr. Mahmoud al-Shawarbi. So after Malcolm split from the Nation of Islam, he started coming here and performing his Jummah prayers here. So we would meet together after the Jummah prayer and have a chat together with each other. So, and it was here that he took the Shahada as an Orthodox Muslim before going to Hajj. Professor Shawarbi made certification that he accepted Orthodox Islam, and he gave it in writing, that he is an Orthodox Muslim, and that he believes that there is no God except Allah, and that Muhammad is the last messenger and prophet of Islam. His real questioning came after his break with the Nation of Islam because when he broke with the Nation of Islam, he was silenced for 90 days. And of course, it was a very difficult thing because he was socially boycotted by the members of the temple, by the brothers and sisters, by everybody he knew. And that is a very severe punishment.
Malcolm X, you were involved in a controversy some months ago with your leader. Is that over?
Well, I've been silent for the past 90 days because of some statements I made concerning the President of the United States, which were distorted.
They were distorted?
And yes.
What did you say, Malcolm?
Well, I said the same thing that everybody said.
Of course, he was quiet, depressed. We asked him, Malcolm, you should go and make the pilgrimage to Mecca. During the pilgrimage, he said, I sat and I ate and slept with people of all colors. Nobody questioned the color of the other person. So this is a new experience for me, which my experience in America told me it could never happen. So this real experience of the Hajj completely turned him over. In Mecca, Malcolm was hosted by Azam Basha, a blonde, blue-eyed Egyptian of Turkish descent. He was the fairest Secretary General of the Arab League and was very protective of Malcolm. But there is this idea that Malcolm only met light-skinned Arabs and blue-eyed people in Mecca. But the truth is, he was surrounded by black Arabs. In Mecca, Malcolm grew very close to Muhammad Surura Saban, politician, poet, and former Minister of Finance. Saban was black, of Sudanese origin. When Malcolm arrived for Hajj, Saban appointed the Sudanese Sheikh Ahmed Hassoun as Malcolm's spiritual advisor.
This is a place where we will stand and chat with each other.
With Malcolm?
Yes.
And I used to tell my friends at Dartmouth about my experience with Malcolm. So the undergraduate student council decided to invite Malcolm because they said that Dartmouth is the only Ivy League school at which Malcolm hadn't spoken. But they said, look here, the university would not invite him and they don't have much money. So they came and they asked me if I could intercede and persuade Malcolm not to come to Dartmouth. So I told him I will try. Malcolm, we would love to invite you to Dartmouth by the student body, but we don't have much money. He said, brother, don't speak about money. Anything you ask me, I'll do it for you. So we invited him as a speaker, and he came, I believe it was on the 26th of January, 1965. He was the only voice of Africa in America. At that time, of course, it was the year of independence of the African countries. In fact, even as a high school student in Sudan, we used to have these demonstrations against the Belgium atrocities in the Congo. We went to demonstrations supporting the elected leader, Lumumba. And so this issue, the South Africa problem, all of these issues, it was Malcolm who was really educating the students, the general public, about the international affairs. So I was coming that afternoon about 3 o'clock from the gym to my dormitory, And one of my students or my friends met me halfway on the campus. He told me, "Did you hear the news?" I asked, "What news?" He said, "Malcolm has been assassinated." I just couldn't believe it. So I ran to my dormitory, I turned on the radio. All the news was about Malcolm assassination. I took the Greyhound bus midnight to go to New York to give my condolences to Malcolm. This is the only time I cried in my life. Yeah. You see, here there is this man, you know, who was going through so much single-handedly, you know, not only problem of racism in America, but defending human rights in Africa, in Vietnam, everywhere. So I came to give my condolences, and I told him if there is any way I could help. So he told me, "We would like you to help us that he should be buried as an Orthodox Muslim." So I told her, okay, I'll try to do my best. I arrived in Harlem, and my God, I never seen New York in my life like that. It was just troops, army, military, everywhere on the rooftops. His former headquarters, Muhammad Temple number 7, at 8 o'clock, the whole building went on fire.
But I'll tell you this, I do believe that this is not the end of it. It's just the beginning. And it will be some more of the same stuff, you know, to follow.
This is not the end of it.
I don't think so. Not by a long shot. It's just the beginning.
Not the end of it?
Started something new.
Anyway, I managed to get myself inside the church where the funeral was supposed to be. And I started looking for the director of the Islamic Center who was supposed to lead the prayer. I just couldn't find a trace of him. The media and the government launched a campaign to discourage any known figures to attend his funeral. People were being, what you can say, stigmatized, anybody who goes to his funeral. And so it was only me and a few students from the Muslim Student Association who were there, about four or five of us. When I didn't find anybody representing an Islamic group, I told them, okay, I'm going to speak on behalf of the Muslims. I'm going to speak on behalf of the Africans. So they agreed, and they told me that I will be the next speaker after Ozzy Davis.
I would like now to call upon first Mr. Ahmed Osman, Islamic Center in Geneva, Switzerland, and the United States.
Indeed, we have known our brother Malcolm as a beloved brother, especially after his last pilgrimage to Mecca last April, in which he has come to know that all races, despite their color, despite their originality, despite their nationality, they can live in peace and harmony with each other. And since that day, he spent about 3 months in the Middle East, studying the true Islam. And after he came back, he never preached any racism, he never preached any segregation, he never preached any separation. But he stood for full equality for his brothers and sisters. The highest thing that a Muslim can aspire to is to die on the battlefield and not to die on his bedside.
I came here immediately after we finished the funeral rites in Harlem. So we drove over here to bury our brother. Rather than professional diggers, we said we are going to bury him by ourselves. So we took the shovels and we earthed the casket into the grave. And we were turning the shovels from one to another so that all the people will contribute to burying our brother. And then we had our prayer. We made the prayer around the graveyard before we finished. If I remember correctly, in that lecture he said, I have been accusing the Nation of Islam, but this is much bigger than the Nation of Islam, especially after what happened to him in Paris when they prevented him to enter the country, although he visited Paris before, you see. So it seemed that something was being planned against him, and I think France didn't want to take the responsibility.
Harlem, ce n'est pas encore la Casbah, mais c'est déjà un ghetto. Une tache noire au cœur de la ville la plus riche du monde.
There is a house.
We have to remember that Paris was really critical for Malcolm's vision. This is where he connected Africa with the Arab world, the Algerian Casbah with the ghetto, and the Third World with Black America.